lot of experts on various world religions coming here. Mary Boyce will be here next week, and Robert Kennedy, James Fredericks, Gabriel Seth Reynolds, and Francis Clooney talking about Hinduism. So I think it promises to be an interesting series. Those of you who haven't been here for a while, you might notice that there's two new tapestries. Francis of Assisi over there, and the Terry Tequequita over there. Mm-hmm. And many of the other tapestries might have moved since you were here. There's this theory that they play musical tapestries at night. jump around. Or to be frank. Well, I want to talk tonight about the Confucian wisdom tradition. There's a friend of mine, Dr. Kathleen Tomlanovic, who a number of years has been trying to help me understand the Confucian tradition and Chinese wisdom and so on. I guess part of my own interest has been because there's a lot of Chinese people in the world, one-fourth of the population, and strong economic force, and military force. And Confucius is one of the great sages of history, so it always seemed to me that we've got to be good to know something about that whole tradition. And Kathleen intensively over this last month has been trying to help me to learn how to pronounce these Chinese names. Fortunately, she is in Bellingham, Washington, and won't have to endure this lecture. Her failed efforts. That's by way of saying that I'm not an expert on Confucianism by any stretch of the imagination. I have made some effort as to following the advice of John Donne, theologian teacher at Notre Dame, his book, The Way of All the Earth, who says it's important to pass over to other traditions. It's important at times to leave your own safe little world and move out and see the world the way other people see it. He calls that passing over to another viewpoint. And that's what I've tried to do, at least in a minor way, I want to share with you tonight. So that passing over to the Confucian tradition, especially because it is so important in the world stage today, because I think in many ways the Confucian tradition has produced what Robert Gullah calls habits of the heart. Habits of the heart that still influence a good number of Chinese people today. And I want to take as the guide tonight in this passing over the great Jesuit missionary Matteo Ricci, and I want to talk about him and see how he directs us in this whole business. I'm going to just bypass a whole bunch of technical questions about is Confucianism a religion or not. Because if this weekend you wanted to go to a Confucian service, we probably couldn't find one for you. But if you wanted to go to a scholarly dialogue at Harvard this next week, where a number of Confucian scholars have gathered, you could do that. So it's alive in that sense, not so much as a practicing religion, but as a wisdom synthesis that continues to engage people and pull them into a deeper understanding of what the human condition is all about. For those people who are into reading, I got this under your notes, but this is a wonderful volume, Confucian Spirituality, edited by Du Guimeng, who I will be talking about throughout the lecture. So there are books there for people who are into that sort of thing. So first, I want to try to deal with Confucianism as a social ethics, a way of bringing together what I call personal morality and interest in the social scene and in political questions. And I do that because it seems to me that we have a great problem with that in our culture. That popular spirituality often just wants to go off in its own little direction, and I'm going to do my own thing. As Robert Gullah says, a young lady by the name of Sheila produced her own religion, Sheilaism, out of contact with anything else. And so I'm interested in trying to integrate spirituality in some sort of larger social political kind of structure. The problem so often today is a privatization of religion. The religion, since the time of the Enlightenment, has been pushed more and more to the margins. It's had nothing to say with politics or economics and so on, but it's good for private prayer. And it might be good for the family, but don't try to bring it into the public square. I mean, there's a line of thought in our culture like that. A lot of times it has to do with ignoring what I would call Catholic social teaching, not being willing to say, well, is there a long Christian vision that can tell us something about the political realm of public policy, how we ought to make decisions in that realm. And of course, politics has a bad word. Even the word politics is often thought of in negative terms. Harsh rhetoric, and people yelling at one another, and interest groups going their own directions, and so on. So that's what I perceive as one of the problems that we face in our world today, and contemporary world, is this privatization of religion and spirituality, so it has little to do with the political social realm. And my contention would be that by passing over to Confucianism, we will get a whole other understanding of that particular question. And as advertised, I said we'd talk about Matteo Ricci, Li Ma Do, as he was called in Chinese. It was born in an interesting year, 1552. It happens to have been the year that Francis Xavier, the first, great missionary who went to Japan and so on, and his great dream was to get to China. And he got off the coast of China, and he's peering over there, thinking that's where he wants to go to try to preach the gospel, and he died in that year, 1552. And it's as though Matteo Ricci eventually got around to doing what the great Francis Xavier was not able to do. Well, I think his father had him mapped out for a career in law and sent him to Rome, and the Jesuits got a hold of him, and that was it. So Jesuits became a Jesuit, went to study in different places, and eventually he gets to China. Now, when he gets to China, he's looking at an unknown world. He don't even know if there's two countries there or one. Well, the theory is there's two countries, China and Cathay. So, I mean, the Western world knows almost that Marco Polo had been there since he was. He didn't speak Chinese and wasn't clear always what he was trying to tell us about what was going on there. So, Ricci is just going into this, sort of difficult kind of situation. But he goes to the great trouble of trying to learn Chinese and immerse himself in the culture. When Francis Xavier preached in Japan, he didn't learn the language. He didn't really learn the culture. He made some serious mistakes as a result. And Matteo Ricci, following the footsteps of Francis Xavier, said he isn't going to make that mistake. So he learns Chinese and learns the culture and immerses himself totally in that world. I mean, it's one of the great passing over efforts in the whole history of humanity. Now, but Ricci had tremendous talents. He had a great understanding of science. He learned languages easily. He had a prodigious memory. He was once at a party in China, and they said, "We heard you have a great memory." And he said, "Well, I didn't want to talk about it." So they got a book off the shelf and let him read about five or six pages of it. And then he gave it back to him like that. So they thought, "Well, you've read that before." He said, "Well, so here's what we'll do. We'll write down 50 Chinese characters, and we'll all write them at random so he knows possibly he's going to see it before he reads that and gives them back the 50 characters, and then does it backwards." So, I mean, we're dealing with a man with immense talents and also with a wonderful personality, an ability to get along with all kind of people, be respectful of other traditions, of being willing to be humble in the face. So he represents a whole effort to learn from the Chinese. And one of the things he learned early on was to distinguish the threads that made up Chinese culture at that time, in the 1500s when he got there. What the threads, and he figured out three main strands. One we call Taoism. When you see it, it's written, it's T-A-O. As you pronounce it, the T's is D, so it's Taoism. The great work is the Tao Te Ching, about 5,000 words of epigrams that supposedly come from Lao Tzu, founder of Taoism. So, and that's a very mystical kind of religion and very in tune with nature, very into sort of letting go of all the realities of the world. And at that time, Ricci saw Taoism as being very idolatrous. And it's not going to help him to move to the center of what Chinese thought is all about. The second group that was active in China, and I probably ever since the first couple of centuries of the Common Era, was Buddhism. And that's how he approached it when he got there. He wore the robes of a group Buddhist monk. And he sort of presented himself that way. I had no idea what Christians were, but they had a long history of Buddhism, of Buddhist monks. So he presented himself, wore the rough garb of the Buddhist monks and so on. But what he found out was that those monks were just, they weren't very spiritual in his mind. There was a lot of idolatry and a lot of strange practices. And he just became convinced that that was not the way to go. And then he uncovered the other strand in the Chinese thought pattern, and that was Confucianism. And when he finally figured that all out, that Confucianism was the route to understand what that culture was all about. It was the Confucianists who had a pure kind of doctrine that he wanted to investigate. And that became his mode of operating at that point. He put on a new robe, became a scholar, a literati as he was called, a member of the Mandarin group, and presented himself now in that way. And of course, with all of his scientific knowledge, knowledge of maps and the world and science, the fact that he had clocks that they couldn't have, and prisms, glass, they didn't have glass. So he would carry prisms around with him and have them look at it. He would sort of see the light refracted through. So it brought a lot of the European science to bear upon him, plus this prodigious memory of his. And then he went about this task of learning the great Chinese classic works, one of which, of course, would be the Analects of Confucius, which took him back to, looking at the thought of Confucius. We'll get to him in a little while. So in studying those texts, they looked pure to him. They looked clean. They didn't feel like they had idolatry around them or superstition or strange ideas. And he came to the conclusion, and this is crucial to the whole history of this thing, that there was nothing incompatible with Confucianism, with what Confucius taught from Christianity. That they could go together. That Christianity was like a completion of Confucian spirituality. And his deep studies in that, and he translated those texts and knew them by heart, and he just was immersed in that world, took him back to Confucius. Now his strategy became, therefore, was to get at the Mandarin class, the literati, the scholars, because in that culture, they're the ones who ran things. At one level, at the provincial level, state level, and so on. They had to take exams in Confucian thought. That's why I think you can make the case that Confucius is probably the most influential single person that ever walked this earth, numerically. He influenced more people than any other person I can think of. And he did it primarily through this civil service process. That everybody who was going to become a public official in China had to learn the Confucian text, had to take exams on it. And so he pervaded the literate culture and the scholarly class. And that's what Ricci was after. And those are the people he went around befriending. and trying to learn from them and influence them gradually. And his grand strategy was to get to the emperor in Peking. And through the emperor, then, would be his means of converting all of China. So time and again, he's trying to get to Peking. He's often helped by his friends, scholarly friends. Eventually, he gets there. And then he had to force him to leave. Finally, right around 1600, he gets to Peking, and he's now established there. In fact, he's on like a state dole. This foreigner, they called all foreigners barbarians. They had no use for anybody else. They didn't think anybody outside of the Chinese knew anything and were unimportant. So he broke through, I mean, the most tremendous barriers you can imagine, to the point where he's allowed to live right on the outskirts of Peking, and actually gets access to the emperor. Never sees him in person, great sadness of his life, but nobody saw the emperor in person except his harem and the eunuchs, the castrated men around him. Nope, none of the mandarins ever saw him. He was being the emperor at age 16, and nobody ever saw him. He had all these decrees, you could have your head just like that. But Ricci got to worked his way in through gifts that he gave him. Two of the gifts he gave him were clocks. The emperor loved the clocks, but about twice a year they needed repair. He was the only one around who could go in and repair them right in the emperor's palace. Worked his way in that way. And the emperor used to send questions to him, like, well, what's the other world like? And what are their kings, what kind of palace they live in? How do they bury them? How do they live? Became very interested in the Western world. And of course, Ricci, you know, always sent him written answers to those kind of questions. But there he was, living in Peking. And he was a powerful figure because everybody else knew that he had access to the palace and had the ear of the emperor. Therefore, people didn't mess with his followers. He protected all of the Christians. There were three different houses around China. He protected all of the Christians through his influence. Nobody could mess with the Christians because word might get to Matteo Ricci that this had happened, and it would get to the emperor, and they'd be finished. So it's amazing how he worked his way into this culture and learned it, and he loved the Chinese. He had an affinity for them. And I want to come back to more about Ricci later on, but what he's brought us to right now is to say, hey, come and pass over to these guys. Come and pass over to Confucius and see what you might learn there. There's a lot to be learned. So it's like an invitation. Don't stop with the Buddhists and the Taoists, but go right back to the original sources, to Confucius himself. Now, Confucius. That's who we're talking about. Lane, did I get that right? Confucius. Confucius, one of the great sages in all of history. Matteo Ricci called him the wisest and holiest of all of the people that outside of the revealed religions. He related him to Seneca in the Western tradition. So he had this great respect for him. So Confucius takes us back to 551 when he's born. A lot of activities right around 500 years before the common era to want to locate him. Now, Confucius's life is something like this. He, wise man, studied all of the ancient texts and tried to pull them together and so on, and became convinced that he knew how to make society run right. He was absolutely convinced of that. And he believed that if he could just get into a position of power, he could prove it. I think in the Analects, it says, it's chapter 13, number 10, it seems that if somebody would just employ him for a year, he could get an awful lot done. And if they gave him 3 years, he could make the work complete. Or in another translation, he would make the government perfect. They had 3 years, but if they just let him run it. So he became absolutely convinced that that was his passion, make the world run better, improve Chinese society. Well, at one point, he got his chance, a minor kind of chance, right around 500 or so. He became the Minister of Justice in Lu. That's where he was from. Lu was one of the provinces. And they were in opposition to Xi, which was right up above them. So he finally gets into this position, and of course he's managing things, and Xi and Lu, two provinces, states-like, are, having this difficulty, and there's a major conference, like a summit meeting, between the two dukes. And Confucius smells out a trap. He thinks that the Xi Duke has got armed forces there that are going to come in and take over in this meeting. And he's really shrewd and he sees this. And so he shames them into withdrawing this plot. Tells them that he knows what's going to happen. And that he warns them that that is not an ethical, proper way to live. And so they back off of using this military force at the time of that meeting. He goes on in the meeting to completely outthink them. He gets them to cede to Lu, his province, or some disputed land in turn for something, favors that they might get later on. So he shows how shrewd he is in this kind of situation. Now when he goes, in his own province, he saw there was three warring families. He got like warlords. They all had their own militia. It reminds me a lot of the Rock today. Three groups with their own militias, and what are you going to do? So Confucius's idea was to disarm them and pull down their fortified towns so that the central government of Lu could be much stronger. So he gets one of the clans to agree to that. And then he has to go to war, the other one, to try to get them, and eventually he gets them in line. And finally, the third one, he really is not able to make it happen. He can't get them, and so the grand plan that he was so confident that he could pull off really doesn't end up working out. Now, let me give you an idea of his what he called sort of a personal wisdom. As the Minister of Justice, cases would come before him. So in one case, a father decides to sue his son. Sues his son, brings him to court, and for not being properly faithful to his father and respectful to his father. Now that could be worthy of death. And so Confucius is faced with a problem because he was constantly pushing filial piety. You've got to honor your parents. That was his major thing. But does he can sentence the kid to death? No. He puts them both in jail for 30 days, then he's going to release them. And the Duke says, what kind of Minister of Justice are you? You're not even following your own advice. And he says, father has failed to teach his son respect and reverence. He too must go to jail. Then they will both murder. The stories of Confucius, of his wisdom in trying to make decisions. Then I think maybe a final story about this Xi people in the north of them are worried that Lu is getting more powerful under Confucius. So they try to figure out how to entrap the Duke. So the leader of Xi sends down something like 60 ponies as a great gift. and along with them,
80 dancing girls,
the most beautiful girls in all of Sheen, are collected and sent down as a gift to the Duke. Well, now his virtue is going to be tested. And for a couple of days, he doesn't greet them, as protocol says he shouldn't interact with these dancing girls. So he's good, and then one of his other clans guys that he's been warring with, he goes and spots them and comes back and begins talking about their beauty. And the Duke gives in, begins cavorting with the 80 dancing girls, and does this for a while, and Confucius gives him 3 days. He says he'll come to his senses in 3 days and return to doing his job, part of which was to sacrifice to the ancestors and so on, and carry on the affairs of state. In 3 days, didn't shave up, and Confucius resigned. Confucius resigned and said he just wouldn't put up with this. He wanted to be an example. You can't govern with that kind of behavior. He was convinced you couldn't have moral leaders without them having a moral center to their lives, a spirituality themselves. And so he left town slowly and stopped at an inn close by so they could pursue him and beg him to come back. Which they did. They got there and he refused to come back. And he said at that time, "A woman's words can cost a man his head." And left public office. And so his whole passion, as you see, was to, "I can do this. I know how to do this." There's other sayings in the Analects that say, if a country had a ruler, a wise ruler, for 100 years, then violence would be conquered and there would be no more homicide. After 100 years, I think he was chastened by, didn't make it in the 2 years of straightening it all out. So that's something about this great founder of a spiritual tradition. So what I wanted to go back to that now and say, what does that tell us? Well, for Confucius, it all starts in politics. Well, it's the politics that's first. It's the social order, in a sense, that he's interested in. I suppose in our terms, we say that was like the final goal. That's what he wanted to work out. He knew it had to start in the human heart. And it had to start in relation to one's family. It had to spread out like that. But there was the political that was his passion. So spirituality had meaning simply in that terms, in terms of being able to create a just and equitable and especially harmonious situation. And he was convinced that what we needed in public affairs was civility. We needed to be able to talk to one another, and to sit down and reason with one another. Well, and we couldn't have all these just interest groups. We had to people come together that would be interested in the common good. So he'd be calling us, so I'm trying to say, well, does he help us overcome this bifurcation, this dichotomy between private spirituality and the political realm? He does it in what I call an organic way. You know, that's what life is about. That's what we're called to do. We're called upon to help make the world a better place, to work for the common good. And in his mind, public service is the highest thing you could do. Politics was rich and wonderful. That's what human nature calls us to make our contribution in that way. So he would call us, I would think, to develop what I call the public virtues. The virtues of participation in society. The virtues of citizenship. The virtues of trying to create a more just and equitable social order. And he does it by his wonderful words in the Analects and in many other ways as well. Well, that's my friend. I got 3 of these that I'm trying to work with. And Let's go on here and see what we can do. Next, I'm dealing with the question is of the otherworldly spirituality. I can look up here and say, well, a lot of these saints were not married. We don't have enough married saints. We don't have enough saints who were factory workers or engineers or doctors or lawyers or whatever. So that in our own, you know, Catholic world and broadly Christian world, there's been an emphasis on saying you get holy by getting out of the world. You come closer to God by going out into the desert, going into a monastery. In fact, we're in sort of a situation in our world where we think the greatest wisdom comes from monks. From, you know, our great guru these days has been for decades now is Thomas Merton, a monk, who lived a very different life than almost everybody in here. He's active and working and so on. I mean, Thomas Merton had all day long to pray if he wanted to work with other things. I mean, so we've got a sense of the monastic notion of spirituality, that the way you get holy is to get out of the world. And that it becomes, again, very private. I'm going to get myself to heaven. I'm going to get my soul to heaven. And I think along with this, I talk about the cult of the spectacular, that there becomes an interest, well, I want to have an appearance of the Blessed Virgin Mary or something. That's what will cement my faith. Or that's where I really put my faith, is in these appearances, the extraordinary phenomena that are around. So that's what I'm trying to deal with here. And I believe that the Confucian spirituality can help us that way, because it is, in a sense, a very worldly, in a sense, almost totally worldly spirituality that's put before us. So now the person that I'm dealing with is Zhu Xi. I don't look like that, but Kathleen tells me Zhu Xi. He's, just to locate him, he's sort of like the Thomas Aquinas of the Confucian tradition. 1200, Thomas Aquinas died in 1274. They're roughly contemporaries. And he's the one who sort of synthesized the tradition, brought a whole lot of things in, gave it a more theological or metaphysical twist. He lived in a culture that was fascinated by Buddhism. Remember I said there were three strands? Taoism, Confucianism, and Buddhism. And during his time, Buddhism was very strong, and he was fascinated by it. But he came to distrust it. And what he ended up not liking about Buddhism was its otherworldliness. Again, the same ideal, the same problem I was talking about, that the ideal is the monk. Goes off, celibate, doesn't get married, lives in a monastery. That's how you get holy. Or you get enlightened, and when you get enlightened, you see that the material world is illusory. They talk about it as Maya. Material world is going to take us away from the spiritual. It's illusory. It keeps you from recognizing your true self. Enlightened people know that. And so that's a world in which Zhu Xi grew up, a Buddhist world, and he himself was into it, fascinated by it. But he went back to the classic works, just like Ricci did, and studying those, and began to get a new take on all of this. He learned them by heart. He used to repeat two of the main texts 10 times every morning as part of his study routine, which we'll see is important in what he was all about. So, what you get, and he's part of what we call the Neo-Confucianist movement that started right there in what we think that was the Middle Ages. He was died in 1200, just to locate him. So, he's saying now, what we've got to develop is this sense of living in the now, in the moment. These are the virtues that count. In other words, it's almost like prayer would be an escape. To think too much about God would mess you up. What you want to do is stay in this world. Stay in the activities now. Be attentive to what's going on. Do the best you can in all situations in the world, here and now. It's interesting that Matteo Ricci was not happy with this line of thought. He began to think that it became too theological. He could live with Confucianism and the standard text because they stayed in the moral realm. But Zhu Xi began to speak more in a theological way that bothered Matteo Ricci, and he says, I can't go there, I don't really want to do all of that. In this life, this is typical of Confucianism, the rituals of life are so important. You want, in Ricci's life, he learned to kowtow. Kowtow was to reverence somebody who was superior. That's in our own culture. The kowtow comes from the Chinese. And he learned to do that. He learned to give gifts whenever he went someplace. He brought gifts from the emperors in Europe to the emperor of China. He wrote answers to everybody who wrote him, a note, and in a certain stylized form. And all the family rituals were important. It was absolutely important that you reverence the ancestors and participate in the annual Confucian celebrations. So, Zhu Xi and all the Neo-Confucianists were saying, the rituals are important. Those aren't just forms you go through. They help root you. They help keep you in the here and now, in this world. They make you attentive to the people you're interacting with. That's why the son has to have proper reverence for his father. All the right relationships have to be at work in that way. Thomas Merton talks about this. I'm going to use my notes here as a sort of memory peg, but of the kind of virtues that these Neo-Confucians want us to practice. One is Zhen, which means that you treat everyone like an important guest. And that's what they did. I mean, hospitality was everything. You had to treat people like an important guest. That's what Ricci played on that when he first got to China, on your guest. You need to treat them properly. You play to that. So that's the kind of everyday virtue we want to do. Treat everybody in encounter as an important guest. Then there's Yi, moves first to treat others fairly, not for personal gain, but out of moral obligation. So you're nice to people, treat them fairly, because that's the right thing to do. And then there's Li, which has to do with getting into these rituals. It's like you don't bring the gift and share the gifts in just in a perfunctory way. That won't do it. You immerse yourself in it. You get into it. You let that take you over. And then there's, unbelievably pronounced as Ger, or wisdom that gives direction to all the other virtues, like orienting them to heaven's will. Now, I might as well spend a minute bringing that in, because in the Confucian tradition, in the early texts, there's this thought of heaven. Heaven is the source of everything. There's a mandate from heaven that guides us. Heaven becomes the symbol for what Ricci thought is the personal God he wanted to preach. The Lord of Heaven is how he translated that and how he talked about it. This is the God I come to preach in Christianity. The Lord of Heaven. And all of this everyday stuff, following the rituals, doing what we're supposed to do, being courteous, kind, civil, that's our way of getting in touch with and sharing the energy of heaven, of the Lord of Heaven, following heaven's will. See, that's what this guy, Zhu Xi, thought there was like a cosmic energy at work in the world. And that by doing the right things and attending to what was here at hand, which is one of his books on the things here at hand. Telling Ty, that's what he wanted us to deal with. That we got in touch with this energy. Well, and Ricci wanted to relate that finally to the great God, to the God that he came to preach. These people are very big on study. They want a
us to study these texts carefully. You know, they, Zhu Xi said that if you spend 10 days intensively reading, glued to the text, you become a virtuous person. Well, somebody might want to experiment with that on their vacation. Glued to the text. Did you fish and do that? I don't know. Glued to the text. Oh, savoring every kind of word there. That this is what would do it for me. This whole line of thought thinks that human nature is very good. If we can just follow it, we'll be fine. I want to say, there's a way it seems to me that Ricci did this in his own life. He wasn't just a scholar. Some of the things that really impressed me, one of the times he was trying to get up a river heading for Nanking, and there was these rapids. There was actually three different barges like they were on. And one of the barges that had the women and the children got into big trouble. They were ready to sink. And the people in his boat, the captain and the sailors, you know, just wanted to forget them. I mean, women and children, they're women. This was a patriarchal society. I mean, you know, they bound the women's feet from little, when they were little, so they couldn't walk well. The whole thing was, you know, we joke about that, keeping people in the kitchen, but that's what they did. And they distorted women's feet. They made about half their size and with a high arch, and they couldn't walk. Couldn't go out in public. Was there a way to do it? Well, anyway, this other boat with the women and the children and the sailors, they don't care about them. And Ricci just, like, takes command of the boat. Forces the captain to go over with them. And then when they get over there, the sailors on that boat all jump over and leave the women and children there. But what does Ricci do? Risks his own life and goes over and gets the women and children off that boat and brings them into the overworld. He had great compassion and empathy. One time, the people were... little kids were stoning his house. He was the only, all the other Europeans had left. He was the only one there. He had some servants and so on. And kids used to make, you know, as the foreigner, the barbarian, throw stuff at him and all that stuff. So they were going to, caught one of the kids and held him in the house for a while. Well, some of the mandarins who didn't like Ricci then reported him to the governor that he was abducting this boy and going to sell him into slavery. It was like a modern Carmen Bernardine story or something. And so it is brought before the governor. I mean, this could have been death for him or deportment. So he's going along and he's been no place, and the governor's going along and looks like he's going to be deported. And then somebody who had been an eyewitness to the thing came forward and said what happened. And then they had this terrible practice of beating prisoners. And it was said that if you took 30 of these blows, you probably wouldn't be able to walk, and if you took 50, you'd be dead. And so this kid was sentenced to 30 of these, and Ricci just implored the governor to stop. For everyone, just everything, trying to get him to stop this beating. He was so afraid for this kid. And then couldn't stop it, it went on. But you get a sort of sense of his empathy for people. When he finally did get to Beijing, he was, there was a big flood, 1604, and Ricci was out there helping all the victims. And also, here is this guy dressed in the silk robes of the Mandarin and higher class, a scholarly class, this great scholar. But then time after time, he was there doing the concrete good thing. So I'm seeing Ricci and this whole thing as a way of trying to put us in touch with what we call a worldly spirituality. One that doesn't use prayer as a cop-out. That realizes that we need to try to promote charity in everyday situations. And that it called that the path to holiness is through the daily, through the routine, through the ordinary activities. And it called to say, you know, let's raise up the good married people. Let's raise up the people who work well and are humane at the work site, and the professionals who do a good job and help other people. We need a spirituality of marriage. It says you can find God as much in the bedroom as you can in the church. Well, we need a spirituality of work that says that's how we spread the kingdom. So, and we need discipline to do it. We need to talk about the practical virtues, the virtues of charity. So that Juche, the new Neo-Confucius, old Confucian tradition, is buttressed by Matteo Ricci, our guide, says that let's not just escape from the world. Let's not set up two classes of people in the church, the celibate priests and the nuns who don't get married, live in community, and everybody else. We need to have equality. Everyone's called to holiness. That path can pass through the everyday. Well, third and final one here. That is that the problem here is essentially dualism. So we saw privatization as the first essential problem, otherworldly spirituality that we're in danger of. And this is dualism. This is bifurcating life, of thinking the soul is like stuck in the body. It's like making great separation between male and female. It's like Rosemary Ruther says, the real original sin is the dualism of gender, of male and female. Or the dualism between the sacred and the secular. So in our world, we live with all of that kind of things. And in out of those dualisms, very often we get a type of individualism that takes over. That I'm going to do my own thing, follow my own way, pull my own strings, and so on. Well, that's what I call the Western context. The Chinese context for this is the 20th century of China. It was all the way up until 1906 that all the officials had to take those Confucian exams. Now, that's why I say Confucius is the most influential figure in all of history numerically. Because millions of people influenced by the Confucian tradition. So, but in the 20th century, and one of the key dates they always talk about is May 4th. They don't even explain it. It's just May 4th. It happened to be 1919. And at Peking University, the students started a great rebellion against the traditional values, against Confucianism. And they said, all of that is keeping us back. It's keeping us from being like the West. So they began to see the Western material progress, the economic successes of the West, science with all that was doing, given a higher standard of living. And so the 20th century in China is all played out against that background. How can we westernize? How can we modernize? How can we have the economic advantages that the West has? And of course, when the people of communists took over in 49, they did the same thing, repudiated Confucius. They couldn't let him teach him in the schools or anything. That was all out. So Confucianism did stay alive in the industrial East, in Japan, Taiwan, South Korea, Singapore. Mostly there you could still talk about Confucius, but not in mainland China. Now, a new group arrived. They didn't know what to call themselves. So instead of calling themselves the Neo-Confucianists, they called themselves the New Confucianists to distinguish themselves. That really got started in 1958. And the figure that we're going to look at here is Du Wei Ming, who was actually born in China in 1940. And essentially, he says that China's lost its way and the modern West has lost its way. That without spiritual values, we're going to have this materialism, we're going to have economic progress at any cost, we're going to ruin the environment. But we know in China, we've got our own problems here. In China, it's unbelievable. I remember when I was in Guangzhou, I had a vision. I had been giving some series of lectures in Hong Kong and then visited Guangzhou, which is a thriving city. And I'm standing there in this phalanx of bicycles came down the street. Thousands of bicycles. And I suddenly thought, what if all those people had a car? The rest of the world wouldn't be able to breathe. Wouldn't be able to breathe if they all had a car. And of course, now that's what's happening. We get a westernization of this. It was just a moment of like insight. You know, what does this mean for 1.3 billion people to be moving into the Western world and modernization, mechanization, and all of that? Well, Du Guiming is convinced that this is a bad path. The communists are taking him down. This will never work. They'll end up secularized, they're already secularized, but they'll end up like the Westerners, with all the crummy values and putting too much stress on money and materialism and so on. So he became convinced that the only way out of this was a new vision of the world. He called that vision an anthropocosmic vision. Anthros, man, anthropos is man, human being, cosmos, the whole universe. So instead of the anthropocentric vision, which is what often we say we have, we run the world and human beings are the main species, and as Thomas Berry, my teacher, said, if all the species were to get together and form a parliament, the first decree of the parliament would be to throw out the humans. Because we mess things up. But he wants an anthropocosmic vision, in which everything is in harmony, in which the whole world holds together. And all these dualisms are seen as false. The world isn't really like that. If you talk about above and below, or male and female, it's only for the purpose of stressing interaction, of mutuality, of respect, of getting an energy flow going between the two of them. That's what the yin-yang symbol suggests to us. Yin-yang symbol, black and white. So that he thought in this other vision, we would then see how we're connected in with everything. We're connected in with the whole cosmos. We're connected in with all the members of the human family. Now we're connected in with all the people in our country. Connected in with all the people in our parish. Connected with all the people in the family, our extended families. And all of that grows out somehow of the harmony that has to exist within us. So it's a vision of harmony. It's the opposite of the Western world. You know, we're into competition. We're into tensions. A lot of my own lectures that you hear me talk always about the tensions in life. Tensions between hope and realism, between community and individual. The new Confucianists say, not so much tension, not class struggle like the communists want, harmony. Harmonious relationships, that's what we want. We want harmony inside of ourselves so that we're peaceful. One of the reasons that they emphasize sitting meditation, just sitting. They want to spend time, just sit. Don't do anything else. Don't read or don't do anything else. Just sit. And be in the real, be in the now, be in the moment, just sit. Call it sitting meditation. It's one of the big things they stress. And a reason for that is to get the inner harmony, to get one's own self together. And then when we're together, then we can relate to our family, can relate to our friends, can relate to the larger society, and finally to the world of humans, and finally to the whole cosmos. And so, like we saw on that among the Neo-Confucianists, there's sort of like a genetic code that influences everyone. We're all touched by a certain genetic package. And it unites us in this very deep sense. There's a quote that I want to read to you that sort of captures, I think, what a lot of this is about. Only when... We're going to see at the end of the quote, it's self-cultivation you have to start with. So let's do it this way. Only when things are studied is knowledge refined. But study hard, a classic text, study. Okay? Only when knowledge is refined are intentions authentic. You have our head straight in order to get our heart going and intention in the right way. Only when intentions are authentic are hearts and minds rectified. Got to have the authentic intentions. Then our heart and mind will get in order. It will be harmonious. Only when hearts and minds are rectified are personal lives cultivated. That's when we can grow spiritually, develop, and so on. Only when personal lives are cultivated are families regulated. Only family, after we get together, work it out. Only when families are regulated are states governed. Back to Confucius. Family, the building block of society. And only when states are governed is there peace under heaven, under the source of everything. Therefore, everybody, from the highest to lowest, everybody must take self-cultivation as the root. Again, I'd like to just raise up Ricci to try to make the point. A man who I think finally had his faith as the basis for all that he could do. One time in his deepest disappointments, he was on a barge, had been in the barge for 11 days, and then finally gone down, he's never going to see the emperor. It ain't going to happen. He's got to deal with that. And then at that point, Ricci, on a finger out there in the deck, and they said, if you come to this land to destroy the religion and bring a new religion, Ricci thought, he never said that. He had never said what is perfect. How can you not? So he said to the guy, you're either God or the devil. Which is it? And the figure then became very paternal to him and comforting and assured him, you will get to the southern capital and you'll get to the capital of Peking. It was a deep religious experience for Ricci. And it cemented it in for him. It gave him back his confidence. It helped him feel at one with his faith, at one with his... He was now living harmoniously again because God had given him that grace. And so I think that's what the new Confucians call us to get the yin and yang together, as they say, to try to have an organic sense of life, a comprehensive sense of what it's all about, to see spirituality as relational. It's all about proper interactions. It's all about people. It's all about relating to nature, relating to the cosmos. So the invitation has been, come and pass over with the Confucian tradition. Come and pass over, and with that wonderful guy, Matteo Ricci, a saint, a holy man, one of the most brilliant missionaries in history, and a man who invites us to go deeper into the great message of Confucius and into finding God in the ordinary things of life, helping people in need, and then pulling it together in some unified religious comprehensive vision that can guide us and give us a sense of inner harmony. Why don't we stop and take a couple minute stand-up break, and then we'll see if we have questions and comments. Remember, come next week, Merry Boys, 5:30. Don't miss it. It'll be terrific.
Confucius preceded Jesus by about 600 years? 500 years. What aspects of what he taught would you say sort of prepared a favorable grounding for the reception of Jesus' teaching?
Well, what Ricci determined that he saw three things in the traditional Confucian text, all of which could be disputed, but one was a belief in one God, who was called Heaven, Lord of Heaven. There is a statement in, I think it's in the one of the four classic works that says, everything comes from the Lord of Heaven. And there's a mandate of heaven for me. So Ricci thought that the text said they believed in monotheism. So that, and you can't get much better than that. The second thing that he believed was in it, or he could get out of it, and again, all this is disputed, was the immortality of the soul. That people live on in relationship to heaven. Lived on. And thirdly, that there was moral obligation. There was a moral obligation to do good, to avoid evil. And that there was something we could know. So those are the three things Ricci found there, and saw that, and that he could come in and say, well, the Lord of heaven you're talking about is the one we call God, and he spoke to us through Jesus. I mean, it was all kind of, I mean, he had crucifixes, and they thought they were some sort of fetish. It was, you know, really hard to get to the cross, and you had to, in a sense, go easy with a lot of the niceties of incarnation and redemption, but he thought that was the preparation for it. So I think apart from what Ricci said, I would say, and he did say this too, that he believed the practice of the Confucian virtues, like respect for family members, and like industriousness, and honesty and sincerity, authenticity in relationships, that would prepare you for the gospel, that it moved you in that direction. Well, I mean, it's clearly not, I mean, he'll say thing in there about whether you're supposed to love your enemies, he sort of puts that down. Oh, I don't think so. So it's a very naturalistic ethic, and it doesn't have the same feel that the gospel has, but clearly it's a, I mean, my own sense, it's a wonderful spiritual tradition. And anything that opens up the human heart and sort of gives a sense of transcendence or harmony with the world is preparation for the gospel. That's how Ricci saw it. Today, if I'm talking to Du Wei Ming at Harvard, I mean, it's not a question of converting Du Wei Ming to Christianity. I mean, Confucianism is his mindset, it's his spirituality, it's his way of seeing the world. I say, now, what I'm saying is that what we would enter into dialogue. I'm really feeling bad that I didn't say it. I'm just going to go ahead and say what I say. Part of a question. But it's the obvious question. I mean, what came of all this? And although it'd be part of the Chinese wisdom tradition to say, well, forget it. He put in the effort, that was good. But as a matter of fact, he did make a lot of converts. There were a lot of Christian converts. And after his death, I think there was a couple hundred thousand in China pretty quickly. But the major thing that happened was that they got permission, they eventually got an edict of toleration in 1692 to preach Christianity freely in the Middle Kingdom. That's incidentally what they called themselves, the Middle Kingdom. They were the center of the world. They weren't China or Cathay, the Middle Kingdom. An edict of toleration within half a century after Ricci's death, or more. So, in other words, he succeeded in getting to the emperor in a situation where he already had a growing number of Christians, and especially among the literati, the scholars, who were the influential people, that was spreading. It was all set up. Hundreds of thousands. And then that's when Rome came in. In the early 18th century and squelched the whole project. It all hinged on the rights to Confucius and the ancestor rights. Were those idolatrous? Were they worshiping Confucius as a god? Or were they worshiping their ancestors as gods somehow? And Ricci became convinced that it was not. That it was perfectly fine. that it was, that they could do that. And he was not a milquetoast in this. He had strong feelings. He didn't, for example, he did not allow any converts to retain their concubines, their mistresses. Many of them had many of them. He would not allow that. And he also would not allow them to have the typical Buddhist funeral rites, which became, you know, superstitious and so on. He wouldn't allow that. But he allowed them to do the annual veneration of Confucius and the annual and the veneration of your deceased ancestors. Well, that's what opened it up. And then Rome came down, the early 18th century, and said, you can't do that. Can't do that. I think it's probably one of the most consequential decisions in all of history. It was a commission of 9 cardinals that studied it, all Italian. None of them spoke Chinese. None of them knew China, anything. And I think one of the most consequential decisions in all of history. We got 1.3 billion people today who don't have a clue about Jesus, and I think it was set up that just like happened in the Slavic countries, for example, it was set up for China to become a Christian nation. So the geopolitics of our own time are tremendously influenced by that decision in the 18th century. And that incidentally, which was reversed in 1939. So now you Catholics are allowed to do the ancestor worship, not worship veneration. They do it. You know, you come up and it's like coming up in church and there would be an urn representing, you have flowers and fruit and you take incense and put it in. In other words, it's a ritual that they do. Catholics around the world, the Chinese Catholics do that. So Rome woke up in 1939 and decided that we would allow this. Anyway. Ricci was tremendously successful in that sense, that within a century after his death, the whole thing was set up to probably Christianize China. There was 1.9 million Chinese when he was alive. So, I mean, he had a large population here. And all of that down the drain because of Roman history. But how about a microphone so people could hear you?
Is that the reason why Ricci is so unfamiliar as a household name compared to Francis Xavier?
That's part of it, I think. In other words, he was repudiated publicly, officially for 2 centuries, is what it amounted to. The people who... I don't want to offend anybody in here, but it was the Franciscans who came 2 decades later after Ricci who decided that the rites were idolatrous and petitioned Rome to make this decision. They're the ones that stirred up all the problems around it. Things were fine. They decided it wasn't legitimate and it was idolatrous and got that message to Rome and won the case before the commission. On 11th decree, no more of the ancestor violence. Yeah, I think that's one reason. Yeah, Ricci, I think there are probably ways in which you'll become better known now, I think. Some people wanted him up here. He didn't make it. Yes.
We have some sort of classic little mini text that we sometimes pull out of the New Testament to introduce people or highlight key ideas of Christ, the golden rule, the great commandments, etc. Are there any sort of epigrammatic little sayings of Confucius that kind of are summary statements of areas of his own wisdom or spirituality?
Did they put up? Look at the animals. They should find on page 11, yes. It says here, he's talking about his own life. the master said, as Master Kong, Kong Futsa, how'd I do, Kathleen? Kong Futsa. And it's Ricci who gave him the name Confucius, Latinized it. That's how we, it's through Ricci that we got Latin Confucius. The master said, at 15, I devoted myself to learning. And at 30, stood firm. At 40, I had no doubts. And at 50, understood the mandate of heaven. Which is very important in terms of whether there's a religious transcendent component in this thought. The new Confucians argue that there is, and other people will deny. At 60, I listen in effortless accord. How's that sound? You listen at 60? Well, you aren't there. And this is wonderful. You're going to love this. And at 70, I follow the mind's passing fancies without overstepping any bounds. Here was his favorite disciple, Yen Wei. I can talk with Yen Wei all day and he never disagrees. He seems like a fool. But thinking about he is when alone, I realize that he reveals my most essential principles. Wei is no fool. Master Tang said, each day I ask three things of myself. Have I been trustworthy in all that I've done for other people? Have I stood by my words in dealing with friends? Have I practiced all that I've been taught? The analytics are, this is the first, chapter one, the first analytic, they're numbered in the book, that's how you plan it. The master said, this is considered to be a description of himself, to learn, and then in its due season, put what you have learned into practice, isn't that still a great pleasure? So that's what he wanted. He learned all this wisdom, knew how to run things, knew how we can have a harmonious state. He's just looking for the chance. Just give me a chance. This is a great pleasure. And to have a friend visit from somewhere far away, isn't that still a great joy? Simple things of life. When you're ignored by the world like this, and yet bear no resentment, isn't that great nobility? That's himself. Ignored by the world. Great sage, one that Ricci thought was the holiest of all of the wise people in the whole history of the world. One of the great figures, most influential man who ever lived, I believe. And he's talking about his own resentment. And he's ignored, and yet bear no resentment. Isn't that great nobility? So that's sort of how he starts out. You know, his analects are probably collections of things that he said. I mean, most people don't think he sat down and, you know, wrote them all out like that. But, how's this? In government, the secret is integrity. Use it and you'll be like the pole star, always dwelling in its proper place, and the other stars turning reverently about it. Integrity, the public world. Master said, shall I explain understanding for you, Lu? When you understand something, know that you understand it. When you don't understand something, know that you don't understand it. That's understanding. In speech, avoid trouble. In action, avoid regret. Then rewards will come of themselves. Oh, geez. Someone asked Confucius, why aren't you in government? What about a dad? Why are you in government? The master replied, the Book of History, one of the classic works, the Book of History says, honor your parents. Simply honor your parents and make your brothers friends. This too is good government. That's really being in government. So why govern by serving in government? So it takes us back to the fundamental relationships, which he always thought was the family. Great virtue was the filial. Ooh. I don't know if I should read it. And to recognize a duty without carrying it out is mere cowardice. So he could be sharp with this. He was big on ritual. You had to carry the rituals out. That's what was wrong with the duel. It's with the dancing girls, with 80 dancing girls, instead of doing the rituals, doing the meeting people, giving the sacrifices. He's not doing what he's supposed to do. Here's one that sounds a lot like Taoism. The master said, the noble-minded, he's always talking about how noble-minded people are, how they live, how they act. The noble-minded never contend. It's true that archery is a kind of contention. But even then, they bow and yield to each other when stepping up to the range. And when they step down, they toast each other. Even in contention, they retain their nobility. Well, the only sport I think that happens in now is golf. Where there's civility. Is there any other one? What other sport is there not trash talk? One of the students said to me the other day after our volleyball game, sorry for the trash talk. Friendly volleyball. Staff and students. Well, we have another question. Yeah, please.
The communists have had various times been successful in suppressing spirituality and so forth. So do all religions get equal amount of intolerance, or do you think the Tibetan and Buddhists are singled out?
In terms of intolerance?
Yes.
By Nietzsche or just looking at
by the present.
Present world state. Yeah. Religions are always, it seems to me, a mixture of grace and sin. I mean, I think that's a nice way to start to frame it. All religions, Christianity, is always a mixture in concrete form of grace and sin. And one of the dangers of all religions in the modern world, postmodern world, is fundamentalism. Fundamentalism, it thinks, becomes exclusive and defensive and worries about the modern world, needs to attack, needs to be aggressive. And what's interesting is we have fundamentalism in all the known world religious traditions and all the ideologies. So you got a fundamentalism in Judaism, in Islam, in Christianity, in Buddhism, in Hinduism, and in Marxism. So that I think that it seems to be just part of the human scene, the religious scene that we deal with. I think at the same time, if you look at all those religious traditions, they have resources to overcome that. They have something that critiques it. Some element, some prophetic notion, some wider vision, some other scripture texts, some people who live it out in a different way, who say, no, the exclusivism isn't right, the intolerance leads to trouble. But anyhow, you could make a case of all the world religious traditions that have that other side to them. I guess we'd like to call that forth in some way. Yes, we got a microphone for you.
What do you think God's fundamentalism would be if he were sitting here today?
Well, one should be careful of characterizing God. I'm always more comfortable being agnostic about God, what God says and God is doing. I could get trapped into saying something. God is a mystery. God's beyond all words. God's beyond all images. God's ways are not our ways. It sounds quite as the most important thing you can say about God is and know about God is that we don't know God. Augustine says if you found God, then you're wrong. And I take it an immediate agnostic posture on that. However, if you look at the best of the religious traditions, let's take the monotheistic traditions, all the Abrahamic, three Abrahamic religions, Judaism, Christianity, and Islam. You can find a lot of texts in there that will cut two ways. You can always find texts that sound exclusive and harsh and condemnatory, and you can always find texts that are more inclusive and loving and so on. So as human beings interact with the ultimate mystery, the gracious one, as I like to call the mystery, it seems as though we've teased out two different kinds of approaches. I think that to link the word God with fundamentalism as though it's saying something about how God really is in God's self would be a mistake. I think those two words don't go together. It's wrong from the beginning to think you can peer into God's essence and say what God is or isn't like, I think. But you can't, the linking the word fundamentalism to God is not proper. We got one more maybe. Do we have one more? It's quick. Then we're leaving, going home, calling it a night.
I was hoping.
I'm not going to give a long talk on knowledge.
That's just what I was going to ask.
I call it. It's the vibrations. That was your question, right?
Yes. If you would just speak just briefly on where they diverge.
Yeah.
The Taoist integration of the righteousness.
The Taoism flows from Lao Tzu and the Tao Te Ching. It's where I think it's usually thought of this way. Confucianism is all about the here and now and the stability of order. It's got a strong political dimension to it. That Taoism has been more mystical, more otherworldly, more into a meditation that would sort of take you off in another direction. The Wu Wei concept is extremely important, W-U-W-E-I, Wu Wei, which means non-action. That's been very important in the Taoist tradition. That is that you need to step back, that a lot of times the right thing is don't do anything. The best emperor is the guy who sits around and never does it. We could probably tell 100 Taoist stories like that. And it's that the Taoist is able to then act spontaneously. The Taoist is not worried about results. Here's a Taoist story that, if I can put it together. That when the golfer goes out just by himself on the driving range, he swings fluidly and it's wonderful and it's all easy and works. Then he's in a match for $1. Suddenly, his muscles don't work as well. And now he finds himself in a tournament. And in the tournament, he's just a basket case. He can't function. He's forgotten the essentials of Taoism. He should have renounced the fruits of action. He should have concentrated on swinging right and not worrying where it went. He should concentrate on enjoying playing in the tournament and not getting hung up on whether he wins it or not. That's Taoism. Taoism for golfers.